Hi, and welcome to Talking Tech. I'm your host, Alejandro Hoyos, and today we have a very special guest with us. His name is Darren, and he's going to be talking about this new building block that we have in Meteor Lake, which is called the Neural Processing Unit. So the NPU, or the Neural Processing Unit, is completely new for Meteor Lake, and I am very eager to learn all about it because this is completely new for me. So please tell us a little bit more about it.
Sure, yeah. I guess I can use this diagram here to explain it. Well, first off, just to describe the motivation, the reason we have this is, we see the number of use cases for AI seems to be exploding, right? And a lot of these use cases we want to bring to the client, but these algorithms are actually running on the CPU, and you're kind of limited by the amount of, efficient compute you have. You can actually make the algorithm better, but then it's going to burn too much power. So when we bring the NPU, it's basically kind of a power efficient way to do AI. So you can take those algorithms, you can actually improve them. They'll take more compute, but we basically have, power efficient compute.
We think about it at Intel in three different chunks. We have AI that is low power, optimized for always on doing AI, and that's our NPU. Mm-hmm. And that's a very optimized piece for delivering good performance at very low power. We also have the CPU. So when you're doing light AI or occasional AI and you need very low latency, you can just run it on the CPU. People have been doing this forever. But we also have a GPU. And the GPU is actually better organized for large batches of AI. So if you're doing some kind of content creation or you're doing some kind of filtering of data, all of that would really be well run on the GPU. Three different IPs that use three different software paradigms to bring AI to the client. The cool thing is we're working on the software layers that allow developers to access all three of those IPs very easily. So we're using industry standard API layers like DirectML or say Onyx Runtime or even our own OpenVINO. And that means that developers can pick and choose not just which IP they want to run, but also what API they want to use to develop their AI applications. For us, it's back to that big Intel strategy, which is build a hardware platform that's awesome, and then be open in our approach to software. So we're using industry standard APIs, and we have an optimized API for ourselves or an optimized SDK using OpenVINO.
Essentially, this is the NPU section, and then here's kind of the rest of the system. So we basically have kind of two components. One is, let's say, like the host interface and kind of the control for the NPU, and then the rest is kind of the compute portion. So the host interface portion communicates with the host that does all the kind of scheduling and memory management. The host interface also controls the scheduling on the device, power management, those kind of things. And then everything below here is kind of compute. Really the heart of the NPU is our fixed function compute block. We're calling it the inference pipeline. When you have a neural network, basically the majority of the compute kind of boils down to matrix multiplication. So we have what we're calling the MAC array in the inference pipeline block that does all that, matrix multiplication. Actually, there's a lot of neural network operations. If you look at like OpenVINO, for example, there's like 160 plus kind of operators we have to support. Not all of them are matrix multiplication or activation functions.
AI is really just a computational problem, right? You're running lots of these things called MACs, which are multiply accumulates. All AI algorithms are generally large trees of multiply accumulate across big data sets. So what we found over years is that the precision of that calculation is not that critical typically. So instead of running a full precision of 32 bits, often AI algorithms work very well with smaller, less precise math. And that's called int8, which is just an 8-bit integer operation. So if you imagine, if you do smaller math, you can do more of it and get higher performance. That's what DP4A does. It takes our 32-bit SIMD register and it divides it up into 8-bit chunks so that we can improve performance by 4x for AI.
Typical sequence of operations you have in a neural network. So we basically have kind of these three blocks, kind of the MAC array, the matrix multiplication, we'll have the activation function block, and then a data conversion block. So we have a DSP. So this DSP is basically fully programmable. It can essentially support everything, but if you did matrix multiplication on it, it's just not nearly as fast as our fixed function hardware here. But if we have a lower compute operation, or we have some operation that just doesn't happen very often, we would run it on the DSP. The key things for neural network execution or neural network power are really how many times you read and write data, and then also how efficient your kind of matrix multiplication is. So through this, we can get a lot of data reuse. We have kind of internal register files, let's say, inside our Mac array, where we can get a lot of data reuse that can help reduce the power consumption.
Okay, so we have covered what the hardware side, but what about drivers and software side?
So there's kind of like two factors in the software. So the first is what is the driver model for the device? And that basically means, how do we do the power management? How do we do the memory management? How does the security work? So we have a driver model called MCDM, which is the Microsoft Compute Driver Model. Then the other part is, how does the developer program the device? What's the programming interface? What's the programming API? And there we've tried to have kind of a common API across the different hardware we support. So it's GPU, CPU, or NPU. We're all supporting, DirectML, WinML, OpenVINO, and Onyx Runtime. So we're trying to ease the developer experience. I mean, that's really the key for adoption.
So this is great. How do you give us an example on applications?
Let's say you're doing video conferencing. You want to blur the background. You wouldn't have exactly this kind of network. You'd have what's called like a segmentation network. So in that kind of network, you would have, different filter values. Let's say you're running, OpenVINO, you essentially would load the model. That model has a description of what the neural network structure looks like. And then it has what the filter values are. You would have put that through the compiler, and the compiler would have compiled essentially the machine code for what's going to run here. You would put in an input image. So your input image, you put in the picture, your face is there and all your background is there. And then what the neural network would go do is it would give an output, and it would, again, say for every pixel, foreground or background. And then from there, it's going to go to maybe the GPU to do the blur. So the GPU is going to basically get that, mask, kind of the foreground background mask, and it's going to take in the image, and then it's going to apply a blur to any pixel that like says it's background, and then not do a blur on any pixel that says it's foreground.
How are we expanding AI into the client side? Because nowadays, we know that most of the AI is done at the cloud.
But yeah, it's really interesting. Well, starting at the top, which would be, why do you want AI in the client? Right? If it's in the cloud, what do you need in the client? Well, there's lots of reasons. One is, if you have AI running locally, then you don't have to share your data with all these different services. So if you're doing like financials or your private pictures or whatever you want, having that local is very important to a lot of people. The second thing you can do is effectively have lower latency. So if you're using AI for facial recognition or for some kind of fingerprint or maybe even creation, the latency to go up to the cloud and back can actually degrade the experience. So having high performance, low power AI capability on the client is critical going forward.
For you as an architect, as a design engineer, how do you get per se predict the future? Do you have a little crystal ball? Like, how do you design for the future? I don't know what's coming up next.
Yeah, I mean, the exciting thing about the field is everything moves so fast. So, and this is all incremental. I think we have the right kind of base architecture. So we're making kind of, incremental tweaks. So let's say like a new paper comes out and there's a new kind of network architecture. We'll take that and then we kind of analyze it. We do like a simulation to see what's our performance. And then we look to see, like what's the bottleneck? What's taking the most amount of time, or maybe are we not having good enough efficiency? So then we go look to see, should we add some new fixed function hardware in the inference pipeline, or should we tweak, let's say, some of the way that we're processing data in the inference pipeline, or should we add new instructions in the shaved DSP? I mean, in Meteor Lake, we added a few new instructions based on new activation functions. There was new activation functions that were coming out. So we're like, okay, well, we want to make those faster. In our analysis, we showed that was a bottleneck. So we added new vector instructions to the DSP, for example.
Well, I mean, if you think about Intel's history and strength, we're all about scale. So in this case, Meteor Lake is going to ship hundreds of millions of devices over the next 5 years. And so that installed base will attract multiple different types of applications. And we can only imagine what this platform's going to do. Our strategy is to build the hardware, build the software infrastructure, and then work with ISV partners to deliver the best experiences. That includes folks like Microsoft and Adobe and others that are basically building AI-enabled applications today.
As you can see, Meteor Lake, from an architecture point of view and also from a product point of view, has a lot to offer. From new AI, new graphics, new process technology, a completely new type of architecture when we go from monolithic to disaggregated, brings a lot of new features. Thank you for watching with us, and please stay tuned for more videos that will be coming your way.